We've started our campaign for 10 in a row with a 5-1 victory against Hamilton. I mean, it was pretty academic, pardon the pun.
Yeah.
But it's a job that needs to be done. It's difficult to play so against 10 men.
That's good. I like that, by the way.
That's the actual. That's the points in the bag. Celtic are top of the league, so job done.
Well, you said that you wanted goals, John.
Yeah. Celtic needed to go top of the league today, so that's hopefully that's where we stay.
Yesterday, Kieran Tierney won the FA Cup, Stevie. We were all big fans of Kieran Tierney when he was Celtic's left back. Have we adequately replaced him?
Definitely not. And it's another conversation we've previously had, Paul, when we spoke about Ronnie Dallier. Ronnie Dallier is now responsible for two of the best defenders in the English Premier League, in Virgil van Dijk and Kieran Tierney. And none of the two of them have been adequately replaced. I know we don't have the finances to go out and spend £25 million for Kieran and £75 million for Virgil, but I don't think Greg Taylor or Christopher Ayer are adequate replacements for Celtic for the two guys.
What's been your thoughts, John? We've seen both of them. You know, Bolingoli started off as the first choice. Taylor came in, took him a while to get into the first team. But, you know, I think it's been a bit stop-start for him as well. Do you think that we can go through this season with what we've got, or do we need to strengthen at left back?
I think you're actually better having actually more cover, but do we need to strengthen at left back? I'd like to see, I think actually Taylor has got the potential, and I'd like to see him given a chance.
One of the names that's standing out for me is Tommy Rodgick, Jim. Now, Tommy Rodgick was, you know, a fan's favourite. You think about him scoring the winner in the Invincible season against Aberdeen to wrap up that treble, but he's been a bit part player for Neil Lennon. Can he play a part this season?
I think he can. I think Rodgick could be an influential player as the season goes on.
What's happened to Bolingoli?
I have never seen anything in Bolingoli that would make me depend on him. And I don't think that Neil Lennon wanted to play him again after the game the 29th. I thought he was finished. Mm-hmm. I thought Tom Rodgick wanted to leave. And just to give a wee example, Stephen O'Donnell, who was linked continuously with us as a right-back, he now doesn't have a club. The Premier League started yesterday, and Stephen O'Donnell's sitting in the house watching football on TV. You know, so we've got to be really careful. The guy's got a game for the other team, but are they good enough to play for Celtic when you're trying to pursue this magical 10? I don't think that. I would prefer Greg Taylor to Bolingoli, but that doesn't mean that you're a Celtic left-back.
There's a few other names that we've not even spoken about, and one of them is Lee Griffiths, who hasn't made the bench. Over the summer period, he came in for a bit of stick for Neil Lennon. John, do you think Lennon manages Lee Griffiths well?
I think Griffiths is fairly difficult to manage. I mean, obviously, we all know his issues. I mean, they're actually well published. Griffiths is a guy, though, when he actually plays for Celtic, it gives you 100%. So I still think Griffiths is a good option on the bench at all times.
Now, with regards to Lee, it's someone you've got a bit of knowledge of yourself, Stevie. What was your thoughts over the pre-season? What could you fill us in with?
Well, Lee's going to be 30 years of age on the 20th of August. You know, so he's not a young man anymore. Came through at Livingston. You know, what was that? 2006 to 2009. So he's been through 125,000 fees, 250,000 and £1 million to Celtic. But where he is just now, probably he's the best place he could be with Neil Lennon, having suffered mental health injuries, you know, himself, and maybe been able to help Lee with him. Regarding his fitness, we had Lee Griffiths practically every day during the pandemic training at St Rocks behind closed doors, him and his brother from the same family unit. So when Neil came out and said he was overweight and unfit, it was rather surprising, you know. And I know the level to play for Celtic, you have to be super fit, but it didn't look as if it was a pound overweight. So I don't know if maybe Neil's protecting him from something else. Fitness wise, you looked okay.
Now, Jim, you and I are members of the Oddson Edwards CSC, aren't we?
Yes, definitely.
Now, we know that not everybody in the room shares those views, but there's been a lot of transfer speculation. And Stevie, you made an interesting point. We're still looking for a striker, big money striker. Are you concerned that Celtic might be thinking about selling Oddson Edwards?
I'm not concerned about Celtic selling him. I'm concerned that he wants away, because I think Celtic right now would be throwing anything at him to keep him at the club. The fact that we're continuously being linked with centre-forwards of a much higher quality than we've had to sign recently, then I think that's a worrying sign.
Now, John, what's your thoughts on Eddie this season?
Listen, I think Edward's going to be an important part if we can manage to keep him. Edward will always come up with a goal. my thoughts on Edward is I like to see 10 outfield players working. Edward's one of those players that, I mean, doesn't he actually put in a full shift? But it's difficult to argue that case at times when nothing's happening and out of the blue, Edward grabs you a goal. But I think it's going to be difficult to keep him. As we said earlier, with the transfer market staying open till October, I can see an offer coming in, and I think the offer may come in for Leicester.
Well, I saw that this morning, actually. Yeah. You know, he's still on Brendan Rodgers' radar, isn't he? Yeah. How much are we talking there, John?
They're talking 40 million now, whether that's pie in the sky. But, I mean, if I was Celtic, I mean, I wouldn't sell Edward for anything under 35 million.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at what players are going for, what the going rate is.
I think when you now look at the successes, some of the guys you've already mentioned, Stevie, of players going down to the English League and proving that the Scottish backwater maybe isn't as bad as they think it is. Robertson being an obvious example, Virgil van Dijk. But there's others. Stuart Armstrong started to perform well at the end of the season there for Southampton as well. If Eduard had to go in relation to the carrot being dangled in front of Celtic, how much are we looking at, in your opinion?
I think when the people are in the Premier League, I think now the starting point for them is 40 million. You know, some of them go up, some of them go down, but I think it's 40. You're talking about Tammy Abrahams, Solanke, 30, 35 million. Oxlade-Chamberlain, 40 million. Why would Edward not be worthy of these sort of price tags?
Now, see, when you look at Celtic unfurling the league title, the league flag, rather, and we can't be there, it's unfortunate. Not that I would rather be anywhere else than with you three guys. But today is Jackie McNamara, Celtic legend, former captain. And obviously, Jackie's had a health scare recently. What's your memories of Jackie as a player, Jim?
Brilliant. I really like Jackie. I think he actually reminds me... Kieran Tierney actually reminds me of Jackie when he was younger. And... Jackie McNamara, he was fantastic. He defending, he was good supporting the midfield. He was good attacking, a defender attacking. Jackie McNamara was an overall Celtic type player from a way back, and he deserved every bit of praise that he got when he was with us. And again, I'm delighted to hear that he's unfurling the flag today. I think that's quite fitting. Not just because of what Jackie's been through, Paul, and health reasons, but because I regard Jackie McNamara as a Celtic great player.
I mean, we've been looking at the reports 14th of September for fans coming back into the grounds, but there's only so long any club can survive without that extra income on match day. So the other transfer speculation has been with Chris Iyer. I think the figure mentioned was £27 million. It's a player who I rate highly, John. What's your thoughts on Iyer? Do we keep him and develop him? Is he going to be worth more than that?
I would love to see Iyer stay at the club. I see lots of potential there. I think at the tail end of last season, I mean, there was a few games that he was at fault for a few of the goals. But there is tons of potential there, and I think he's a major asset at Celtic.
I rate him highly, and I see a lot of criticism, particularly on social media, about Chris Iyer's performances. I think when you look at him coming in as a midfielder, being put into the centre-half position by Dyla, the way he's developed in the last couple of years is frightening. Yeah. I think if we keep him and we keep Edward, there's absolutely no way we're going to lose 10 in a row. If we sell one of them, that's when we start to get a wee bit more concerned. Now, that takes me on to yesterday's games. And obviously, the two main challengers over the last few seasons have been Rangers and Aberdeen. We've got Motherwell also as well. What was your thoughts yesterday? Do you think that Hibs might pose a bit of a threat this season?
I think actually Hibs, by all accounts, performed actually well against Kilmarnock yesterday. And once again, in the early stages of the game, Martin Boyle played extremely well. He is a player that I think that I would have at Celtic. His actual pace is electric and gets behind defences. But if Hibs continue with him fit, then I think Hibs will be a threat.
I think Hibs, the main strength that they've got is in the manager, Jack Ross. He's a manager that I've always regarded highly. And I think that obviously that he's bought well. He's brought the boy in Nisbet from Dunfermline as well. And, you know, when you look at the signings, I've been very impressed with Hibs. Do you think, Jim, that they may become a threat that, You know, when you look at Motherwell, the way that Motherwell have managed to be in the higher reaches of the league.
Well, I'm hoping that Hibs do well this season and become second in the league. That I would like to see. I think Jack Ross has done exceptionally well, guys, with Hibs. And again, Hibs seem to come good, and then they disappear, and then they come back again. Have they ever really kept the momentum going year after year through the league season, Paul? I don't actually think they have. But when Neil was there, obviously that was the second result I always looked for. And I think Neil had them playing the way that it was an attacking format as well. But Hibs this season, yes, definitely, I see them as contenders.
I personally don't see a threat to Celtic this year, apart from Celtic themselves. I don't think any of the other teams are anywhere near the ability that we've got or the level.
Very confident, Stevie.
That's a confident comment for you, Stevie. I like that.
Yeah.
I really like that.
When you look at Scott Brown, obviously he's looking lean, he's looking fit, 36-year-old, he's a fifer.
Well, you had to get that in, didn't you?
How long can he maintain that level of performance, Jim?
I think he's still got a good bit in his bag, and with the right players running about him as well, looking after him, and him looking after the players running about him. I think, Stevie, still a couple of years.
I think he's still got a real pivotal role to play in the club, in the playing sense, but I don't think he would have to play every week.
No.
I think he could nurse him through, you know, and you get the 2 year where his experience and the standard that he's been up to, speaking to John previously, since Brendan arrived, you know, it's took him to a different platform, you know, and a level of performance. So I think it would be good just to keep Scott and keep him not turning over.
How do you replace somebody like Scott Brown? Because obviously the development took quite a few years at Celtic Park before he became the player that we see today. Do you think that a player like Callum McGregor is your replacement?
I don't think Callum would be a direct replacement for Scott Brown. I think Callum McGregor, in my humble opinion, is probably one of our best players at the club just now. But I think you could nurture somebody, whether it's going to be maybe Sorrow, to come in and develop him. You know, he's got the full season playing beside Scott Brown. You know, getting, so if it's bring him on with 20 minutes to go to get him with Callum, I think there'll be a big changeover in the Celtic team this year.
Do you know, Paul, if we take our minds back, guys, the start of the 9 in a row, was it Aberdeen was the very first game that we started that with? Did we think that we'd be sitting here today in season 21 looking at going for 10 in a row? I think it's magnificent, and it's a dream come true for me, and I've been waiting, I suppose, all my life for this as well, Stevie, Paul, and John.
Do you take more pleasure out the first 9 in a row or the second?
That's a great question for you three guys.
Yeah.
It's an ageism thing you've just done there.
Aye. Johnny,
I'll
be
honest with you, I think when you looked at the actual competition that we faced in the first 9 in a row, in all honesty, I would take more pleasure out the first 9 in a row. And that's not to say that the second 9 in a row, I mean, is any less important. But I think the actual competition was stiffer during the actual first 9 in a row.
Absolutely. I would be the same. I would take that as well. But I'm going to take more satisfaction out of this 9 in a row.
Why is that, Jim?
Because another club have equaled the 9 in a row, so we do 10 in a row, then it's satisfaction coming from a Celtic supporter's point of view and for the history of the club as well. So more satisfaction out of this one.
I guess, you know, that competitive edge, I heard Derek McInnes talking about it yesterday, the competitive edge of the crowd that gives you is not going to be there. But if you're a professional playing for Celtic, Stevie, does it really make a great amount of difference? Every player I speak to says they just drown that out.
Well, when we were speaking the other day to the ex-professional who played in front of 60,000, 50,000, when I asked him how you deal with the noise, or albeit it was going to be the lack of noise, he says you don't hear it. It's just a hum, you know, because you're concentrating on your role within the park. You know, you're not actually listening to the crowd. And again, obviously, knew about my background, he says it's more intimidating playing at a junior game with 50 people there because you can hear everything that's directed to you, and a lot of it's personal.
And you look at a player like Edouard, some of the kind of comments I see on social media is that a lot of the players don't care about 10 in a row because they're not the Celtic core, you know, they've not come through. P- people like maybe in the past, your Van Dijks and Dembele, etc., who are using Celtic as a springboard to further success. Do you think that would be right about Edouard?
I think it would be bang on, actually. I mean, these players have got no intention of actually staying for 10 years at a club like Celtic. Celtic is a brilliant stepping stone for these players. And let's be honest with you, it's actually great for Celtic as well, because our actual scouting system has actually delivered a lot of good players for good value, mm-hmm. and we've actually turned them into quite a lot of profit. So I think that's the marketplace that we're in, and we just need to actually utilise these players while they're at Celtic Park. But are they interested in 10 in a row? Listen, I think they want medals, they want championships like anybody else, but they won't be around for 10.
Again, when we were talking earlier about Scott Brown, and again, I don't know what your guys' views on it, would you replace him with a guy, Ferguson, at Aberdeen?
I think Ferguson's an excellent player, and I just don't know if that would be the move he's looking for, Stevie, you know? And is he one of the best players in the Scottish game? 100%. Would you have him at Celtic Park? You would.
I would.
John?
I would have him at Celtic Park as well. Mm. He's actually shown lots of potential. He's got a lot of dig in his game. He's a good grafter, and he makes a difference on the park.
Karamoki Dembele, what should we expect? I mean, he's 17. We've seen him over in Romania, didn't we? Making his European debut at 16 years of age. And is he going to get a lot of game time this season?
I think he's got a great opportunity. I think with Karamo is that his problem will be he doesn't go down the same path as Farouz. If he can be nurtured and guided, then that boy could be a sensational for Celtic, and I think he'll be a prominent player this year.
I agree with you there, Stevie, that providing he doesn't go down the road for us. So Karamoko in the right hands, in the right guidance, and the right advice could become a good Celtic player, and his head doesn't get wasted with people saying, maybe go to this club, maybe go to that club, you'll be better off at this club, there's more money there. So if the right person looks after him, then I think we could have a player for a few years that could show and could have great potential.
I think if you listen to the podcast that you've done with Frank McAvity today, Paul John, and he was talking about Alec Ferguson,
yeah,
with his mum and dad. Mm-hmm. You know, that has a massive influence on the kids, aye, and the parents involved. They've not given their son to a football club and they're left to develop there. They're made to feel part of it, you know, and that could be a big, big thing at that age.
Without a doubt, we had John Colquhoun on last Monday. He was the first guest within the State of Mind studios that have been built here. And John was Islam Farouzi's agent initially, wasn't he, Jim?
Yes.
And what he said was his concerns were very, very early doors, where they moved him out to the west end of Glasgow, am I right?
That's correct, yeah.
And when he went in, Islam Farouz had the biggest room in the house and his parents were to sleep elsewhere, but that was part of the culture because he was the breadwinner. So straight off the bat, John had some concerns about how that was going to go. John's management of that player moved on to a completely different agent, and he says, and from there, you know, it just went a lot worse for the young man, because the new agent that came in was basically just looking to sell him down south and make as much money as possible off him.
I was speaking to a friend of mine about that this week, that if you get the young players with potential and they go into the wrong hands with different types of agents and whatever, they do waste their heads. And, you know, with Farouz, although he wasn't really my cup of tea, but if he was kept with the right agent and the right people guiding him, it could have been a lot different for him. He may have been part of the historical nine in a row team, because when you look at that age group that came through in Celtic there, I don't think he actually played any games for Celtic. He went away to Chelsea, mm-hmm. and there was other players within his same age group that went on to become part of Celtic's historical nine in a row, and players that showed that they wanted to play for Celtic. So there you go, in the right hands or the wrong hands, it depends what road you go down.
But again, Paul, I mean, these actual players, I mean, I know and agree with everything that the guys are saying, but I mean, we're talking about Karamoko, mm-hmm. and you're talking about, now, first and foremost, I mean, before he gets all these opportunities, he needs to prove it on the park.
Yeah.
And as of yet, and the, I mean, when we've seen him over in Romania, I mean, his performance here was pretty poor.
It was poor.
Now, yeah. I think with the current pandemic and the five subs, I'm hoping that the young guy gets more game time this season. But where's Lennon going to play him about?
This is a question. I mean, he's certainly not going to replace any of that team that started today.
Definitely.
But he's going to, I think, get fleeting appearances maybe on the right-hand side. And then you're looking at James Forrest, who's one of the most productive players we've got.
One of my thoughts as well, and it's is that what can Neil Lennon, as a coach, do for a young kid like Karamoko?
I think it comes down again to the games, but he's only 17. This is the big thing about Dembele. A lot of players, I mean, I know that Tierney came in at the age of 17. Carl McGregor was 21 when he played his first game for Celtic. So if he wasn't to play too many games this year, would it really affect his development?
I think we take it back a wee bit too much, and we go back to the great Barcelona team the night they beat Manchester United in Champions League final. And Graeme Souness, again, that somebody that everybody likes as a Celtic fan, when he says the best three in the park wouldn't be scouted in the UK football.
Mm-hmm.
Messi, Xavi and Iniesta, because of their size.
Yeah.
You know, if you're good enough, you play. Size really should. That's why we're getting held back. You've got to be 6 foot two and an athlete. If you're good and you've got the ability, get on the ball and play.
Well, the interesting thing was, his big brother played with you, didn't he, at the Jimmy Johnson Academy?
Aye.
And one night at training, he says to Jim, I'll bring my wee brother along. And Jim was not that interested. So I think that was one that you let get away there, Jimmy.
Aye, definitely. I was going to bring him along, aye, but say, would you know? Aye, would you know? No, but he was doing the team in Govan, but his brother did come along and he played with us for a while. That was Brian that reminded us about that, wasn't it, Paul? And thanks for reminding me and your viewers that's listening as well. But no, I think he was happy where he was anyway. But you could see the talent, Stevie. No, when he was playing the soccer sevens at Tory Glen, you could just see the talent.
Was he 8 year old at that time?
8, 9 year old, aye. No, brilliant.
You think, Jim, when Paul goes into the team at 18, and aye, he's a man at 18, you know,
correct,
they're still children at 17, 18.
Aye.
You know, Paul McStay battering through Jim Bett, etc. Mm. You know, real aye, quality players and dominating a game at 18. If we're going to have anybody to replace Scott Brown, is there anybody at the club who can do that just now? Can I go back to the Lee Griffiths thing, Paul?
Yes.
If you take Lee Griffiths when you're just talking about actual goal scoring, 22 goals and 48 appearances for Livy, 21 goals and 47 appearances for Dundee, 12 goals and 26 appearances for Wolves, although he was a top goal scorer when we signed him, 31 goals and 66 appearances for Hibernian, and 84 goals and 151 appearances for Celtic.
It's astonishing. There's a goal scoring record.
Great, great goal scorer. Yeah, even definitely, going back to a kid at Livy.
Mm-hmm.
Many appearances in total, Stevie?
If you get a calculator.
He's definitely got more than roughly a goal every two. Definitely more than a goal every two games.
As I say, but he went, first transfer fee's 150,000, second one's 250,000, then £1 million to Celtic.
I mean, there's been loads of discussions about Lee, and you know, I've always said I think Neil Lennon is the perfect man to manage him. He seems to have that man management. And sometimes the thing that you need to do with a player like Lee Griffiths, and you'll know this having managed clubs yourself, is sometimes they need a wee boot up the backside, don't they?
They certainly do. I think we are, Celtic fans in general just now, is we're all a wee bit guilty, is it? We listen to a lot of the stories, rumours, innuendos about Lee, and none of us really know the true story of what's causing these problems. Is it addiction problems? Is it mental health issues? Is it a fitness thing? Is it a dietary thing? And if you don't know, we're no helping them by commenting, you know, things we don't know what's actually causing them to be out of the team.
Well, obviously, Stevie, sorry, Johnny, there.
Sorry, John.
Obviously, you had him up at the Rock in their training, and you were saying that there wasn't much wrong when he was training. He was looking lean. He was looking fit. How did you see him, and how did you think he was coming across?
He absolutely amazed me at how well he struck the ball.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're limited to your own ability and what you see. You know, when you see on a football park during a game, you don't really get a chance to study it. When he was close, 18 yards, striking free kicks, I thought, they're okay. Seeing he was going to 30 yards out, I've never seen anybody in life that close up who was able to hit the ball so well. As I told you, his brother was a goalie, and when he came back the next day, his brother likes saving shots with his legs, It was as if he was black and blue and somebody had been hitting with a stick. It was absolutely fantastic ability. But he looked good, nice, humble guy, no arrogance about him, just he came across personable.
Now, his brother, was he an ex-St. Rock's goalkeeper, Stevie?
The worst goal I've ever seen in my life. Sorry, Aaron, sorry.
I hope Aaron's not listening.
Aaron was a football player playing in goal, loved saving the ball with his feet, tackling with his feet, never went out with his hands in his life.
Right.
Even going back to the start, Paul, when we were talking about Jackie McNamara, Jackie, for me, was the treble under Martin, because Jackie was greatly out of the picture, you know, under when Martin came. And proved himself that much, his worth, they became the captain under Martin.
Yeah.
You know, and winning the treble.
When you looked at that actual flank at that time, though, I mean, there was two guys on that flank that, that, I mean, and to be fair, what's, I mean, they're obviously actually business partners now.
Yeah, they complemented each other big time.
They complemented each other on the park. I mean, Simon Donnelly and actually Jackie. I mean, it was, to be fair, it was an entertaining watch, and it was very effective.
That's really when Simon Donnelly came into a game.
Yes.
Because remember the Hampden season, at the end of the previous season, he'd scored a few goals, he'd been likened to Kenny Dalglish by Lou McCarrie, but then he had a poor season, and by his own admission.
There was a great wee story about Simon Donnelly from Tam Cowan. He says he was speaking to the boy Chris Doolan, who retired from Partick Thistle. And he says, who's the best player you've ever played with? And he says, Simon Donnelly. So Cowan goes, derogatory, with a bit of sarcasm, Simon Donnelly, that? He went, he came in, and says, right, how are we going to play? He says, and Simon Donnelly, before the game started, told him everything that would happen and where to go before the ball had even arrived. And he says it was absolutely amazing.
Don't you think, Stevie, that the management team of Donnelly and McNamara is sadly missed? Because, you know, it seems to be there's a view formed around the Dundee United comments that were made by the owner at the time, who basically hung them out to dry, coming out saying that, you know, they were on contracts that meant they made money from selling players, but most managers are. If you bring in a player like Andy Robertson for 10, 50 grand, whatever it is, and sell him for 4 or 5 million, then you've developed that player, you've made the club money.
Well, who's the guy that they all love? Harry Redknapp. That's what he was on.
Yeah.
30 players a season, because Harry was on a bit of every deal. You know, became very wealthy. Now he won't go to his bed.
Well, for none more than Graham Souness as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, so I don't really think that's a unique thing in football.
No, definitely not.
We, Jackie, you know, and
good point, John.
We look forward to Jackie getting full recovery. Do we think that even the York thing went badly wrong for him as well?
Yeah, definitely.
That was a bad move.
Yeah,
wasn't it?
You know, and then he became the director, the chief executive, or something.
Mm-hmm. I think Partick Thistle and Dundee United, what he done at both their clubs. When you look at the players he developed at Dundee United, and you know, right back to Ryan Gold, Mackay Stephen, Armstrong, and others, including players like Chiefchi, because I mean, when you think of him at Dundee United, he was an excellent player at Dundee United.
I think definitely actually Partick Thistle. I mean, actually Jackie looked like he was at the start of a promising career.
He did, eh?
Yep.
Kevin Tate at the penalty spot mentions that his only concern today has been the middle of the defence. We are crying out for a commanding centre half. Benkovic?
Well, I mean, I think there yet could be a few transfer dealings between Celtic and Leicester, so that may be one of them.
I think Stevie made that point at the beginning, Paul, did you know?
He did, yes.
You know, Stevie came in right away, a good centre back, solid centre back in there, on the three, Stevie, wasn't it? You made that comment at the beginning.
It's alarming how many headers Hamilton have won inside our box. To be fair, because it's a point you've already made, Stevie, but Hamilton are particularly good and physical up front. They were last season anyway.
But if you're going to do well, then you need to be able to combat that. You know, I said to you the other night, and again, probably people just think it would be a bit of an honour. I watch all the games, and I was watching the Championship playoffs in England. Swansea have the best record. Mm-hmm. They're probably one of the smallest teams in the Championship. But their set pieces are organised by the goalie coach. So he teaches them how to defend.
Yeah.
It's not just a normal coach. They've got the best record for defending corners. So you can set up better that prepares you for defending them.
John, going into that game, obviously with the three tap-ins, has that changed your opinion on Odson Edward?
Listen, what I said at the start of the game is actually still my opinion. Edward is, when you look at the goals, he's in the right place at the right time. And that's what you're looking for from a striker. Edward comes to life in the box, doesn't really contribute that much else to the game. But if that's what he contributes and you get your 3 points, then we'll take that every week.
room for improvement. Would you go back to the centre-half issue, Stevie, do you think would be the main area?
I think it's definitely got to be improved. I still think it would be capable in the SPFL, but if you have any European aspirations, it's got to be improved upon.
Of course,
I know you three guys are going to differ. I don't think Christopher Ayer defensively is capable of playing against good forwards. The last couple of games in Europe, he was getting dragged out of positions often. And I know sometimes he's encouraged to take the ball forward to join in the play, but see, as soon as he's out of that position, it's a huge gap because he's out. So if you're going to continue to play that, I think it's essential that you play three at the back. Who your third centre-back's going to be, because I don't think Beaton would be the answer on that three either. Gain, tall guy, nice ability, no great positional sense and gets dragged out of position. Do you go, and I know your sister's going to get into meltdown, do you go and get somebody like McKenna for Aberdeen? He's just a robust big centre-half.
Again, I mean, when you look at his performance yesterday, and I mean, pretty much the Celtic fans were saying, I mean, they can't believe that we were interested in him.
Were Celtic interested and they were offering something in the region of £4 to £5 million for McKenna?
There was seemingly a £5 million bid tabled, but I mean, I don't think he actually did himself any favours yesterday.
Tony Flanagan, thank you for your message on YouTube. Really positive start. Happy that Klamala is up and running. Eddie is class. I've got to agree with that, because obviously Eddie carried the can all season virtually until Griffiths comes back. Because, I mean, the strikers we had at our disposal then simply weren't doing it. Bayo got a few games, John. There's talk that he might be going on loan to St Mirren.
I mean, I've got to be honest with you, and this is where we go back to the scouting. I mean, we paid, what, £2.5 million for Bayo?
Yep.
I mean, what did that scout see in him?
I know. I'm struggling to see.
I mean,
see
we've
it.
Now seen him, what, I don't know, half a dozen times. And
he brings none to the party.
No, nothing. Well, I think if we actually get a new striker in now, I mean, we've been linked with the guy at Utrecht.
Mm.
Now, whether that actually comes off or no, or there's actually somebody else in the frame. If another striker comes in, then actually Griffiths' position,
I know,
is shaky.
It's shaky. I mean, yeah. We did a podcast, I think it was about a week ago, John, and I asked the question, is Klamala the second choice striker, based on what happened in pre-season? People were quite critical of that, but there comes a time, doesn't there? There comes a time if you can't contribute week in, week out, then you're going to have to get moved on. Interestingly, the strikers we're looking at are all very expensive. They're at the higher end of Celtic's kind of transfer budget, because we have signed too many bios at £2.5 million over the years.
I'm not a cheerleader for Lee Griffiths. I would worry about Lee Griffiths in the future if his Celtic career was curtailed right now.
I would agree with that.
I think his whole life in the future could be determined by what happens in the next couple of months. And I would like Celtic to look after him. I know I've been a wee bit ambiguous with what I'd said earlier on about, you know, you can't just give jobs to people. But I think with Lee's delicate state, I think Celtic would need to look after him.
I think the one thing there, Stevie, is, and it's, I mean, the... I think, to be fair to Celtic have backed them, but more importantly, I mean, the fans have got behind them. I mean, every time that he's made a comeback, you know, and the fans love to see Griffiths scoring goals. Oh, I'd love to see Griffiths scoring goals. Mm-hmm. And what Stevie said there is 100%. I mean, you would fear for Lee Griffiths if his career at Celtic's over.
Where does it go from Celtic would be the question.
I mean, you would probably see him maybe somehow going back to Hibs, I think. But, I mean, hopefully that's not going to happen anytime soon. And hopefully Griffiths can fight his way back into the team.
I wouldn't like Celtic to face a Hibs side with Griffiths up front.
Yeah.
You know, personally. I wouldn't like to see Griffiths going to another Scottish club, because we know what he's capable of, even yet,
maybe
even now.
Take his ability out of it, Paul. It's, do we worry about... Does it become like a Gaza situation, you know, where
I think there's a possibility
he's got to be looked after.
Yeah.
And again, with all the resources of Celtic, surely we've got people that could help Lee, you know, to have a stable life. You know, we can't control it. When people go and they maybe have an addiction or something, you can't be there 24 hours. But I think we would need to offer him every support we possibly could.
I know we don't see it. There's no company, what's ever happening with Lee in the background. And hopefully, and I'm sure they are, Steve, I'm sure there's people at Celtic Park that are genuinely interested in the man and what he's doing away from the park. and what he does when he comes to the park, and hopefully they can help him. And whatever is wrong at the moment, let's say hope that he's getting the support all round.
You do feel though, Jim, time's running out for Lee Griffiths.
All that's left for me to say to Jim Simonetti, John Butley, our official sponsor for today, JBMs, and St Rock's president, Stevie Mullen, is thank you for joining me on a Celtic State
of Mind. Absolute pleasure. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much.